Hey everyone, welcome to the talk for Steve Keen, Can We Avoid Another Financial Crisis? So I just want to thank you guys for coming along to this event. And yeah, I hope you enjoyed the talk. Thank you.
Hi, thank you. I have a pretty tight schedule, and I know that I'm talking mainly to students, economic students here, so I've got a lengthy presentation, but I won't actually go through the whole thing in a great deal of detail. I'll jump around a bit and show you some other stuff that I think you should be learning that I'm pretty certain you're not learning. And one thing you probably have learned is, do you realise you're doing macroeconomic models that don't have any banks, debt or money in them? You're conscious of that? ISLM model. You've done the ISLM model, I presume? Okay. Aggregate supply, aggregate demand. Okay. Has anybody done a DSGE model yet or looked at them or know what they are? Okay. They all leave banks' debt and money out of them. Okay. And a major part of the reason why is this sort of stuff from a guy like a fatally unimportant individual called Ben Bernanke, who, of course, got the job as Federal Reserve Chairman on the basis that he was the expert on the Great Depression. Now, I don't know if anybody here tried reading any of Ben Bernanke. He has a book called Essays on the Great Depression. You can also get the essays online. I wouldn't buy the book. I'd just get some of the essays for free from Econ Lit. Okay, take a look at them. But you would think somebody who is the expert on the Great Depression would have read and seriously considered all of the arguments about what caused the Great Depression and come up to a considered judgment. Now, Irving Fisher, have you heard the name Irving Fisher? Some of you have, okay. He was the Paul Krugman of his day in that sense. He was the most mathematical of the neoclassical economists in America at the time, really the leading. He was in America what Keynes was in the UK in terms of his status. And he was also a tinkerer. I don't suppose any of you had ever Rolodex. Okay. Now, this is a generation check here. A Rolodex is a mechanical version of an iPhone in the sense that it can store just on a rotating device. It stores telephone numbers. You rotate it around, you file it, you put your finger in the hole, and then you dial the number back in the old days of analog telephones. Well, he invented that device and sold it to the RAND Corporation. Have you heard of RAND? Okay. Which was at one stage RAND Xerox was the major photocopying company. Anyway, he made a fortune out of that. So he's a famous economist. He'd been successful as a capitalist and entrepreneur and inventor in his own right. He even made a mechanical device for predicting general equilibrium values in the 1890s. Okay, so he's a seriously interesting character. Madly in favour of teetotalism, all sorts of strange quirks about him. But he lost the equivalent in 2000 dollar terms, he lost the equivalent of $100 million when the stock market crashed. And that was more than he owned. He had about $10 million. Now, why did he have $100 million worth? Because he borrowed on margin. And back in those days, you could put down $100,000 as a margin loan and buy $1 million worth of shares. And if the shares rose 10%, you doubled your money, which is what he thought was happening. Of course, in one day, they fell by 10%, so he's wiped out in one day. And then he looked back and thought, what on earth did I do wrong? Why did I not see this coming? I'm the world's, the country's most famous economist. And what he developed was he called the debt deflation theory of Great Depressions. Now, a major part of that was saying that what led me astray in my writings before the crisis, he wrote was called the theory of interest. That was his PhD thesis. And it was the precursor, in a sense, to the efficient markets hypothesis. Now, I suppose you're learning that, correct? Okay. Well, Fisher realised that to actually make his vision of supply and demand applying in the finance markets, he couldn't just presume supply and demand at a point in time. Of course, because a finance market, of course, you're moving through time. So you have to have a range of when you take out a commitment now, it's both borrowing money now with a commitment to repay over time. Now, that gave him a real dilemma. How do I handle the fact that I'm going through time? Well, there's only one possible way to do it. Everything had to work properly. So he assumed that all debts are repaid, that nobody goes bankrupt. Sort of a problem when you go bankrupt yourself, isn't it? He looked back and said, what have I done wrong? And his point departure was, I presumed equilibrium through time. Okay? And he said, now this is just totally unrealistic. because if you look at it, even if you looking back in the aftermath of being financially destroyed, his reputation destroyed as well. Because does anybody know a quote from Irving Fisher? Nobody knows. Okay. Have you heard of this quote? Stocks have reached what appears to be a permanently high plateau. Heard that one? That's Irving Fisher. Most people don't know the rest of the quote. He then said, I doubt that there will ever be a 50 or 60 point fall in the stock market, such as Mr. Babson, who is a bear commentator, is predicting, over any time period. They fell 50 or 60 points in the next days. He was on the front page of the New York Times saying, don't worry about the stock market, the values are reasonable. Boom. Reputation destroyed, fortune destroyed. The only reason he didn't end up homeless is his wife's sister was wealthy, paid all his debts, and then forgave the debts on her deathbed. And Columbia University, which he worked at, gave him a free house. Okay? So this guy seriously went through the mill during the Great Depression, and he came out saying, my fallacy was believing the economy is in equilibrium. And what he wrote in this paper, which Bernanke is supposedly quoting here, is that even if you believe that all system states return to equilibrium, the belief that the system is going to be equilibrium is going to be false, because there'll be shocks, and necessarily all variables will be above or below their equilibrium values. So you have to model out of equilibrium. That was his starting point. Now, the type of economics you've been learning is equilibrium fixated. You don't learn anything about what's out of equilibrium except how you get to equilibrium again. Okay? Now, Fisher was saying that's completely misleading. You have to think about it in disequilibrium. And what matters is having too much debt, so debt's above an equilibrium value, and inflation too low, so it's below an equilibrium value. Now, that was a vision that gave him an alternative explanation for how the Great Depression came about, called the debt deflation theory of Great Depressions. And here's Ben Bernanke supposedly reflecting on Irving Fisher. And this was virtually all he wrote. He simply said Fisher's idea was less influential in academic circles because debt deflation is no more than a redistribution from one group of debtors to another group of creditors. And absent implausibly big differences in spending propensities between the two groups, there should be no significant macroeconomic effects. Okay? Can anybody see a flaw in his logic there? There's a very obvious one staring him in the face. When somebody goes bankrupt, do they pay their debts back? No. What he's saying here is a redistribution from debtors to creditors. What if they don't pay their debts back? Okay? He's even leaving that obvious point out of his thinking. Now, after the crisis, you start getting mainstream economists talking more about debt. This is Paul Krugman. You know him, of course. Okay? And he's saying, well, it doesn't matter. Debt only matters when there's what he calls a liquidity trap. That's his logic. And he's saying that if there's he's rejecting the whole idea of what's called a balance sheet recession or a debt deflation, because saying, well, if some people are in debt and others lent them money, then when there's a redistribution of debt, the people who get the debt repaid, if the debt's going down, they've got more spending power, so they'll spend more, and that'll balance the fall in spending by the other group. So pretty much don't worry about the level of private debt. And now, of course, the crisis came along, and the whole explanation is to say that we can't be blamed for not seeing the crisis coming, because criticising economists for not predicting the crisis is a bit like criticising mathematicians for not predicting who's going to win Lotto next week. In other words, a totally random event. You can't predict these things. That's the sort of stuff they come up with. And that argues the crisis is unpredictable. And they're also ignoring private debt. Now, what they're ignoring, and this is something I only found when I was writing Can We Avoid Another Financial Crisis, because I had to collect the English data at this stage. I'll just stop that for a second, just go back. The red line is the level of private debt as a percentage of GDP in the UK from 1880 until today. And the blue line is the annual change in that debt. So I define debt is obviously denominated in dollars. Okay. So you divide debt in dollars by GDP in dollars, you get a ratio. And then if you look at the change in debt, that's denominated in dollars per year. So that's the change in credit per year, which according to mainstream economics you can ignore. Okay? Now let's take a look at it. Notice something strange about that data? Okay. From all the way from 1880, when private debt was about 55% of GDP, right through to 1982, which is just after Maggie Thatcher was elected, down here, the level of private debt in the UK never exceeded 73% of GDP. And you'll notice the blue line, which is the annual change in debt, is frequently above and below that little red line there. And when it's below the red line, change in debt's actually negative. Okay, so debt is falling. Then you get out to the post-World War II period, many less periods where it's negative, but all the way from 1980, all the way through to the crisis, positive, and then it goes negative. Have you ever seen that before? Okay. This data has been publicly available for 10 years. Why haven't your economics lecturers externed it to you? Well, they don't think it matters. That's why. Now, what they're saying again, this chart is showing the level of the blue line, the change in debt again, which is credit. I'm showing that, and I've turned the unemployment rate upside down. Because notice early on, I quoted Bernanke as saying that absent implausibly large differences in spending propensities between lenders and borrowers, change in debt, i.e. credit, should have no significant macroeconomic effects. Therefore, if you tried to correlate credit with significant macroeconomic data like the unemployment rate, for example, you should get a correlation coefficient that is not significantly different from zero. Okay? Here's the correlation between the two. The red line is credit. The blue line is the unemployment rate turned upside down to make the correlation obvious even to Ben Bernanke. So between 2000 and now, that correlation is minus 0.7. Now, I'm not a statistician. I'm not an econometrician. I don't regard econometrics as worth doing. I'd rather people learn statistics if they're going to do that sort of work. But I think that's significantly different from zero, minus 0.7. Okay? And then if you take a look at this is the change in credit versus the change in unemployment. Again, turning one of them upside down so the correlation is more obvious. That's a second order and a first order change in economic data getting a correlation coefficient of minus 0.46 when the null hypothesis is it should be zero. You've also had you don't need to tell you there's been a housing bubble. What's Sheffield like compared to London? Not as bad, I imagine. But yeah, okay. That's the level of household debt has gone from 30% of GDP, that's the red line there, to 95%, and then fallen a bit after the financial crisis as house prices rose. And if you take a look at the change in household credit, which is the acceleration of household debt, and the change in house prices, the correlation is 0.76. And I've done the logical mathematics behind this as well to make I've actually used Granger causality, strangely enough, to confirm that that is a causal relationship from change in mortgage debt, change in mortgage credit to change in house prices. And all this is being ignored by mainstream economists. And they've been ignoring it for a decade since it's been made obvious by people like myself and a few others. Now, what's actually going on is they don't understand why it matters. That doesn't mean it doesn't matter. There were once astronomers who didn't understand gravity. Okay? Ptolemaic astronomers. I believe you're being taught Ptolemaic economics. A vision of the world with a stable system, with epicycles to explain fluctuations and stuff like that. It's not that they're using simplifying assumptions to make a complex system easier to understand. They're making absurd fantasy assumptions to leave out the interesting stuff because it challenges the vision they have overall. And just to go through a bit of this, part of this comes back to the way in which money is created. Has anybody here heard of positive money? Okay, a few of you have. And if you know, the Bank of England has come out in 2014, as it happens, and said that banks create money by lending. You've seen that one at all? Some of you have, okay. This is Paul Krugman coming out arguing that banks lend out deposits. Now, 2 years later, the Bank of England says, no, they don't. Okay. So what instead happens is when banks lend, that actually creates money, which is the opposite of what you get taught in the mainstream course with things like loanable funds. So what impact does that have on how you analyze the economy? Well, I want to show you why this credit matters, because you're told by the mainstream credit doesn't matter. And one of the funny things that I've got used to mainstream economists doing over time is when they get a result they don't like, they come up with a fantasy reason for not bothering about it. So Just if I can move the slider here to show you this quote. In, I better make it a bit smaller. I can change that less chunk. Let's go for 200%. Okay, this is a new paper that's just come out very recently by a group of European mainstream economists saying we know that we have to concede now that banks create money because that's what the Bank of England has said and the Bundesbank has said and the Bank of Norway have said, so we can't ignore it because it's just being said by mavericks like Keynes or any of his predecessors like Basil Moore or Hyman Minsky and so on. So they've now got to take it seriously. Now, this is how they take it seriously. We establish a benchmark result for the relationship between loanable funds, which is the argument that banks just lend from savers to borrowers and therefore don't create money. They just introduce somebody who's saved money through a deposit to somebody who wants to borrow money through a bank. And the money creation, we establish a benchmark result between loanable funds and the money creation approach. Now, money creation is what I'm saying matters. What they say here is both processes yield the same results. Now, wait, look at this. This is just priceless. When there is no uncertainty and thus no bank default. Does anybody know a planet where that applies? This is 10 years after an enormous financial crisis, which the mainstream claims nobody could predict, which therefore means it's uncertain, and which caused numerous bank defaults. And what are they assuming a decade later to ignore an empirical argument about whether you should look at banks or not? They're saying, let's just assume there's no uncertainty and therefore no bank default. Now, they will call that a simplifying assumption at a later stage. That is a fantasy. And that's why I'm so pissed off with mainstream economics and what gets regurgitated at universities that you guys have to study. And notice this. In this, I love this. This is where people like, have you heard of a guy called Tony Lawson at all? Didn't think you would. Tony is a ex-econometrician working at Cambridge University who developed a philosophy called critical realism. And a large part of that is about talking about the need for realism, for understanding what your area of study is and so on, rather than just using techniques you might borrow from another one. And I completely support Tony and his attitude there. But Tony is also one of a lot of non-orthodox economists who are critical of the very use of mathematics in economics. Now, my position is quite different. I think we don't use enough mathematics. We don't use the right mathematics. We use mathematics designed for a 19th century vision of an equilibrium system. But this, and what I describe what neoclassical economists do is not mathematics, but myth-o-matics. Now, here's a classic instance. Notice this statement here. Using the much simpler loanable funds approach as a shortcut does not imply any loss of generality. Ever heard that phrase before? Without loss of generality? It's a phrase mathematicians use to say we're going to map from one problem to another and not lose any generality in the problem. So we might map, for example, if you're doing differential equations, you'll map across from the actual equations to a polynomial equation or to a set of vectors, a vector equation, a first order vector differential equation, then get a matrix and discuss the properties of the matrix. And what you're doing of talking about the matrix exactly applies to the equation, so you don't lose any generality. Or you might have a theory saying, as the Wikipedia gives this example, it says, let's say we've got three balls all colored with two colors. Then without loss of generality, I can say if I take the red and the next is a red, then the other must be blue, or vice versa, okay? Without loss of generality, I can start with a blue or start with a red and get the logical answer that's correct. That's the way mathematicians use without loss of generality. Now, what these guys are saying is we can assume that loanable funds and endogenous money, bank-created money, are identical without loss of generality if we assume we live in a planet or a universe where there's no risk and no uncertainty, and therefore no bank defaults. That is not mathematics, that is myth-o-matics. And that's why economists are so useless about understanding the financial crisis. So I've been spent the last decade trying to explain why money matters, why you have to have banks, debt and money in your macroeconomic models. And I've come up with a range of simple explanations. I'll cover one of them for you now and then I'll show how I handle this stuff technically. So imagine you've got an economy I'm calling Tom, Dick, Harrier. Three people, Tom, Dick, and Harry. They've each got $100 in cash. and they each spend $200 per year. So the amount of money you've got can turn over more than once, you know, the velocity of money idea. So you have $100, you spend $200 per year, and everybody, the other two are doing the same thing. So what's total GDP? If there are three people each spending $200 per year, 600, okay? Three times, that's the expenditure measure of GDP, and I can show it this way. I call this an expenditure income table. So what I have is Tom spends $100 per year on Dick and $100 on Harry. Dick spends $100 on Tom and Harry. Harry spends $100 on Tom and Dick. The negative of the diagonal is expenditure income measured by the expenditure method. The off diagonal is income expended by the income method. That's expenditure. The other six are income. They're necessarily the same. That's one important part of macroeconomics. Expenditure is income. Now, in that particular case, you notice what the total of savings are going to be, zero, okay? You're spending 200, you're earning 200, your savings are zero. What happens if you borrow money? Well, in this case, I'm doing the standard neoclassical idea that people lend between each other. Banks aren't really part of the action. Banks are just agencies that introduce one to another. So imagine that Dick lends 10 to Tom and therefore has 10 less to spend on Harry and Tom. Tom's got 10 extra, spends that on Harry, and has to pay interest to Dick. There's the $10 of lending. That reduces the spending by Dick, but increases it by Harry. One offsets the other, and that's the Bernanke position, the mainstream economic position. Tom then has to pay the interest, which is extra income for Dick, and then the money that he's borrowed, he spends on Harry. What about when banks originate money? Well, now I have a bank, which I haven't got on the table, it's off to the side in effect, lending 10 and creating money in the same process, which Tom takes and spends on Harry. So there's the $10 borrowed by Tom from the bank. There's no offsetting cancellation of spending by the other two. The money gets spent on Harry, so expenditure goes up by 10, income goes up by 10, plus the interest being paid to the bank in this case, and then plus the bank's own spending. Now that's a simple numerical example of why it matters, but I'll show you a more elaborate explanation, because one thing I realized a long time ago was we need to have some means by which we can model money in an easy sense in an economic model. Has anybody here heard of what's called system dynamics? Okay, that's what you should be learning, frankly. And system dynamics programs will give you flow charts that build mathematical equations. So I'll show one involving, have you heard of what's called the butterfly effect? Okay. That came from meteorology. And what happened in meteorology back in the early 60s was that a mathematical meteorologist called Lorenz realized that all the models that meteorologists were using to try to predict the next week's weather were either pattern matching, so they say, well, these 5 days occurred in the past, so the same sort of five temperature and humidity distributions can be expected to give us the weather that we saw on the sixth day sometime in the past, or they were linear regression systems, complicated, but basically linear regression. Now, he said, look, we know that the main forces in the weather are nonlinear. Temperature will interact with humidity in a nonlinear way, et cetera, et cetera. So we have to have nonlinear equations, and the equations they developed for talking about the flow of fluids, and air is basically a fluid, a rather low-density one compared to the ocean, but it's still a fluid. The equations are called the Navier-Stokes equations, and a particular class of those are massively complicated 11-dimensional partial differential equations. You don't want to see them. Okay. Solving one of the problems about the nature of the dynamics of that equation is still one of the great challenges in mathematics. And there's doubt that people will ever do it. What Lorenz did is take that set of equations and then derive a very simple system of three first-order differential equations. I'll show you what they look like. These are the equations in text. And all you have is three constants, A, B, and C, and three little equations for the X and Y location and the temperature gradient. Effectively, imagine a drop of water on a hot plate on the stove. Okay, so that there's going to be a temperature differential from the top and bottom, And where's the drop of water going to be on the hot plate? That's what the equations are basically saying. And when you look at them, I know that they look a bit messy, though. I'm trying to zoom in. Actually, I'll move it over here. Hang on. That's a bit easier. Okay. Now, the equations themselves, it's pretty hard to imagine a simpler set of equations. There's the y equation. Notice you've got x multiplied by z, or minus z, in there. There's the, sorry, let's start at the top here. There's the x equation. The value, the mention the xy location on a hot plate, a times y minus x is how fast x is changing, the x location. Then you get the y location, x multiplied by b minus z minus y, and the z equation, x times y minus c times z. Pretty simple equations, aren't they? Three constants, three variables. What happens when you simulate it? This set of flowcharts over here are what engineers invented going on 60 years ago now, a method of building mathematical equations using flowcharts, where the flowcharts are supposed to show you the causal links that exist in the system rather than just the raw equations. And I've got two sets here. I've got one set with x, y, and z, another set down here, x1, y1, and z1. And the x values differ by 1/10,000th. in 10. So an absolutely tiny difference between the initial position of both. If you got to be that accurate in economic stats, you wouldn't throw a party, you'd get the Nobel Prize for being that accurate. Okay? This is the idea about the butterfly effect. It says a tiny difference in how well you know the current position means that over time the amount of information you have will decay exponentially rather than linearly. So after a short period of time, you'll have no idea where the system is going to go. So I'll just run this simulation, let you see it. And they're actually, the bottom one there shows the x value. And you can see that when I plot the z against the x value in that two-dimensional chart up here, that's where the idea of the butterfly comes from. It looks like a butterfly's wings. Okay. Now, notice the two lines are starting to diverge here. And you can see up here as well, they've diverged quite substantially. This is after 12 seconds. So it's saying within a 1 in 100,000 precision, after 14, 15 seconds, you won't know where the system is going to be. Watch how the two lines diverge in a moment. So all the information you had about the system to a precision of 1 in 100,000 is gone after 15 seconds. Okay? Now, nonetheless, when meteorologists first saw this, rather than throwing their hands up in horror and saying, oh dear, we want to make predictions we can rely upon for 3 years, even if they're wrong, so we're going to stick with our own stuff and ignore what you've told us, they said, fantastic idea, Lorenz. We're going to change over to this idea. And they started developing all the models you see in meteorology and weather reports now have as their foundation this wisdom. There's much more to it than just what I'm showing you here, obviously. But that's how meteorologists reacted to realizing they've got to look at nonlinear dynamics. Economists have completely insulated themselves from that. So I'll just show you now applying the same technology to the banking sector. And what I've done, this is a software package you can all download for free from a source called, you know, open source software? Okay, if you go to SourceForge, I'll see if I can bring up my browser. Hopefully I'm linked into EduRoam here. So you go to SourceForge and search for the word Minsky. You'll find you can download the software from there for free. Okay, we're still working on the manual. It's not particularly good at the moment. But what Minsky does is build on the paradigm of these flowcharts to show models to also include double entry bookkeeping. Anybody doing accounting here? Nobody does accounting these days. I didn't do it either, by the way. Hang on, didn't want the description. I want to show the table inside. But what Minsky does is let you define financial flows using double entry bookkeeping. And there's a very good reason why. I'm supposed to make this a bit larger if I can. Hang on. I hate having to go to a single pixel to stretch. So bloody frustrating. Hang on. Ah! Hang on. I'll try my other mouse. There we go. Okay. What Minsky lets you do is talk about flows between bank accounts. I must make the table a bit larger here. So what I've got going on here, I've got lending between a consumer sector and investment sector, money out of the consumer sector's account into the investment sector. repayment between the two, interest payments, paying a fee to the bank. This is all the loanable funds vision of banking. Okay, well, banks are just intermediaries here. And then I have the firms hiring workers, purchasing goods, workers and bankers consuming, bankers investing. All very straightforward to read. Okay, I think you get the gist of it just looking at that table. If I simulate this model, what I control over here are how fast lending and repayment occurs. The smaller the number, the faster the process. So if I make that number smaller, that's saying at the moment loans will double every 9 years, roughly speaking. Well, if I make it double every 5, lending is faster. If you've got repayment being every 9 years as well, so I'm saying every 9 years you halve debt, if I make it a smaller number, they pay it back more quickly. Now, if I simulate this system, notice the growth rate, which is shown here, is pretty much zero. GDP is flatlining at 200. Velocity of money is a total constant. The debt ratio is rising, but nothing is happening to the money supply. The black line there is the debt level. The red line is the money level in the economy. Rising debt has no impact upon the money supply. Now, if I make lending happen more rapidly, so I lower that money. Ah, that's a bug. Pardon me. I'll have to use the up, the down arrow key. That's faster lending. Notice the economy slowed down with faster lending. I'm going to also slow down repayment. You notice the debt ratio is rising quite dramatically. GDP bipped down a bit. It's now recovering. But I've made a huge change to the financial situation of the economy. No impact on the macroeconomy. Okay? Now, if I go in the opposite direction, notice now the debt level now exceeds GDP. If I go in the opposite direction and slow down lending drastically and speed up repayment, the debt level is now plunging. The growth rate actually accelerated when the debt levels were reduced. The GDP is now falling back to the 200 mark again. So I've made a huge change to the financial system of the economy, bugger all impact upon macroeconomics. Therefore, let's ignore banks' debt and money. Okay. Now, what I can do with Minsky as well is rapidly say, let's bring some realism in here. I'll open up the looking at the economy from the point of view of the consumer sector now. Here I go, trying to grab this. I'll use the other mouse. Hang on. Okay, make this a bit larger. So what I'm arguing here is the debt is an asset of the consumer sector. If it's the consumer sector lending to the investment sector, then the debt is an asset of the consumer sector, not of the bank. That's a myth. According to the Bank of England, according to anybody who knows anything about banking, banks create money by lending. Well, I can rapidly show that by deleting, pressing on the minus key here and deleting the debt column. And once I've got rid of it from the consumer sector's view of the economy, it's still there in the investment sector's view because I've got rid of the debt liability. I've got rid of the asset, I haven't got rid of the liability. So the data is still sitting in the system. And what I'll do as well is delete the financial transactions that are supposed to be hitting, like lending, debt repayment, interest payments, and the bank fee, delete those. And then I can come over to the banking sector's view of the system, add room for an extra asset, and say, what liabilities haven't yet been allocated as an asset to somebody else in the system? This is the idea of double entry bookkeeping. If I click on that down arrow, I get a list of all the unallocated assets, and that includes the debt level. There's actually an error there. I was going to talk about this for a second. Software always has bugs. And this is a brand new release, just came out today, and I've just spotted a bug there, which is you shouldn't be seeing C underscore NW and W underscore NW there. Those are actually equity entries, not unallocated liabilities. But that's for the benefit of my programmer, so I can send this little clip to him later and say, you've got to fix that, Russ. If I click on D for debt, the program will bing down all the operations associated with debt. Now, all I've got to do is make sure the rows sum to zero, which is an essential part of accounting operations. So the interest payments, which were being shown as being made to the consumer sector, are actually being made to the bank. Once I've got the same entry with the right sign on the one row, tell me I'm all balanced here. I'll get rid of the bank fee, which is just a fiction of mainstream economics. Banks do charge fees, but that's... I'm looking at the queer making money by lending now. So all I've done is say the debt is an asset of the banking sector, not an asset of any individual. Okay, what happens? Go back and simulate it. straight away the growth rate is positive. The rising level of debt is causing a rising level of money. If lending happens more rapidly, the growth rate accelerates. Repayment more slowly, it accelerates even more. If, on the other hand, lending slows down, so lending takes longer to double the amount of debt in the system, then the growth rate plunges. Now, that's how big a difference there is between the fantasy that mainstream economics is clutching to, because it's part of their overall worldview that they can ignore the financial system. It's all about monetary versus real, and monetary just affects the price level and no impact on them. All garbage. But it's been a religion in mainstream economics, particularly in America, since 1950. I want to get rid of that religion and bring some science into economics. So that's my overall objective. But I know I can't do it in the university sector because, unfortunately, non-mainstream economics only gets a position in the low-ranked universities now. If you go back 50 or 60 years, you would find that there was a mixing of both orthodox and non-orthodox thought in leading economics departments. So have you heard what's called the Cambridge controversies? Have you heard of that? Look it up. Okay. It was an intellectual battle between Cambridge, UK, and Cambridge, America, the University of Massachusetts Institute of Technology, mainly. Paul Samuelson, you've heard of Paul Samuelson on one side. Joan Robinson on the other. Heard of Joan Robinson? No, didn't think so. Okay. The radicals won that debate. Now, if you ask a mainstream about it, there's two possibilities. Either the debate didn't happen, so they don't know it even happened, or they think their side won it. Now, I haven't got this paper loaded, but I'll bring it up just to show you because that's one thing that really annoys me, how they rewrite history. So I just want to show you in the final section of a paper I've just submitted to the Journal of Ecological Economics. Can I see where that's got to? There we go. You'll happen to quote Samuelson from that debate at the end. Now, at the end of that debate, I don't explain the whole logic here, but I'll just it'll help you to see it more clearly. Hang on, where am I here? I want to zoom in. Can you read the Samuelson statement there? Talking about the impact of the debate overall, he finishes up by saying, if all this causes headaches for those nostalgic for the old-time parables of neoclassical writing, we must remind ourselves that scholars are not born to live an easy existence. We must respect and appraise the facts of life. Now, unfortunately, because economics is far more a religion than it is a science, that's been ignored. If Samuelson concedes defeat, I think the mainstream should as well, but they haven't. They've ignored this whole thing. And you've been taught a version of economics, leaving out the curly bits, both in terms of things that didn't work out the way the mainstream thought it should, and leaving out non-linearity, which is one of my major foci, that you have to have a non-linear vision of the economy. Now, one thing which I also find comes out of mainstream thinking is they believe that you have to work from micro foundations. You heard that expression, micro foundations? Okay. So the idea is you start from the individual and then you aggregate to the collective. It's the only way you can do economics, according to the mainstream. There's two problems with that. One, it's totally wrong. Okay. Two is it's also totally wrong. First reason it's totally wrong is when they tried to aggregate, they found they couldn't do it. Have you all done indifference curves and working out a demand curve and all that sort of stuff? Where in your textbook does it explain how you go from a single individual, which is what that curve is about, to a market? You spotted it? Okay, take a look for this on Wikipedia. I don't think I'll agree with how it's explained because it'd be done by a mainstream economist, but it'll give you a bit of a favour for it. Okay, it's called the Sonnenschein-Mantel-Debye theorem. Now, that was a group of mainstream economists, good mathematicians, asking themselves a simple little problem. We can derive a downward sloping Hicksian compensated demand curve for an individual. Okay? That can be done. that's an isolated individual where we presume changing relative prices did not change income. Now, when you generalize to say we're looking at more than one individual, you can't say incomes are fixed anymore. If you change relative prices, according to the theory, you change the distribution of income. So when you generalize, can you still derive a downward sloping demand curve? The answer was no. It's not well expressed in the text, but you'll find them saying that any polynomial can be an excess demand function for some commodity in a multi-commodity economy. In other words, even if you draw a downward sloping, well-behaved individual demand curves for every individual in society, when you add them up, because you're looking at changing prices across a range of industries, the product of that summation can be a polynomial with no constraints whatsoever on the coefficients, which means it's a wiggly line that doesn't cross over itself and doesn't give you two answers for one input on the x-axis. But otherwise, any wiggly line you care to draw is a valid market demand curve. Have you learnt that? It's actually even in the main textbook you guys get thrust in economics these days. And I can't think of the name of it, by a Spanish writer. Anyway, one thing I can accept with the micro foundations perspective is they say we want to have some solid foundation. We don't know if we ad hoc. You've heard that expression against ad hoc models, I'm sure. Well, what I do is called system dynamics. And a large part of system dynamics is based upon saying just build a good description of the structure of the system you're talking about. Put in the simplest possible assumptions to start with about behavior between different system states. But if you get the structure correctly described, most of the behavior will come out of the relationships between the entities in the system rather than how you describe their behavior. So this set of equations here, and again, I haven't explained it well in this talk, I'll just dive over and show you, are three simple equations for the rate of change of wages share of GDP, the employment rate, and the debt to GDP ratio. Now, I can express those in words, and they are very, very simple. The one about debt says the debt ratio will rise if debt grows faster than GDP. Does anybody want to disagree with that? You can't. It's just dynamizing a definition. Wages share of income will rise if wage demands exceed labour productivity. And the employment rate will rise if economic growth exceeds the sum of labour productivity change and population growth. So they're simply factual statements. All I've added into it is an argument, the Phillips curve argument, that wage change depends upon the employment rate. A similar argument for investment by capitalists, saying the amount they invest depends upon the rate of profit. And then if they borrow more money than they have, if the desire to invest exceeds retained earnings, they've got to pay interest on the outstanding debt. That's all I've added to that. Now, what happens when you put that model together? What you get is a system with three equations, again, a bit like the Lorenz one I showed you a while ago, three system states, eight parameters, slightly more complicated, but extremely simple nonetheless. And if I run this model with a low level of capitalist desire to invest, then I get a model that behaves nice and stably. I'm graphing the employment rate, as you can see on the top left-hand chart after that, the wages share down below it, the debt ratio below that, and then the first spiral is showing you wages on the vertical axis and employment on the horizontal, and the bottom one is showing you employment on the bottom as before, but the debt ratio on the vertical. And that's going to slowly converge to equilibrium. Look good? Okay. If I increase the desire that capitalists have to invest to a higher level, I built this model for the very first time, by the way, in 1992. Notice what's happening straight away. First of all, the wages share of GDP is falling, which means inequality is rising, because where the money is going is to the bankers. So what you're doing is a redistribution of money from the bankers, from the workers to the bankers, even though the capitalists are borrowing the money. The debt ratio is rising. The economy appears to be incredibly stable, however. Wouldn't you take credit for an unemployment rate that fluctuates that little? Let's go on a bit further. I'm waiting for the employment to break out. There we go. What looked like a stable system suddenly explodes on you. Now, that's what we had. We had a period that neoclassical economists called the Great Moderation, where there were diminishing cycles, and they took credit for that. Bernanke, in particular, was very vocal about saying how the Great Moderation was due to better monetary policy. Then the financial crisis comes along, and they blame that on exogenous shocks. There are no exogenous shocks in this model. That's a very simple version of the model. If I go to a more complicated one where I have price dynamics as well, and I have nonlinear behavior to it as well, then I get something that behaves rather more like the last 50 or 60 years of economic data. This hadn't been fitted to the data yet. I'm still building the calibration tools to go into Minsky for that to happen. But this is the sort of thing I think you should be learning as part of an economics degree. Instead, you're learning all this equilibrium stuff, which is completely inappropriate for the world in which we live. And that in the 19th century, when economists did that, they had a good rationale. If you read, and I do recommend you do read ancient texts by people like Jevons and Walras and Marshall and so on, and you'll find that in particular Jevons saying that if we want to do political economy properly, we should be doing it as a dynamic process. But we'll do the static stuff now because it's so much easier. And Marshall thought the static could give good training for the dynamic. J.B. Clarke, who invented the marginal productivity theory of income distribution, he thought the 20th century would be marked by dynamic economics. Now, what economists call dynamic DSGE models, in my opinion, is neither dynamic nor general. They're stochastic equilibrium equations. It's just an extension of the whole equilibrium way of thinking. So they haven't done dynamics yet. And most of what they do is a travesty from a true mathematician's point of view. And if I had an airfare to fly somebody from Canada, I'd have a fairly well-known mathematician saying precisely that to you. It's not just an opinion of a critic within economics. What economists do with mathematics is terribly bad. Okay? It's not mathematics at fault. It's using the wrong sort of mathematics with mad assumptions like this one, which is probably going to feature... Yeah, I got it again. Probably feature in the next edition I'm doing of Debunking Economics. Now, this to me is a profession that doesn't deserve respect. Okay? It deserves the sort of fighting you're doing against it. I was doing what you're doing now. I hate to use this phrase, but it's real. When I was your age, okay? I started a student revolt at Sydney University in 1982. I wasn't the first. I was the most effective, but I wasn't the first. It's still necessary. So what you guys are doing, taking on the profession, you've got every right to do it. Keep on doing it. Thank you. Got 10 minutes to go. I've got a dash.
Yeah.
Any questions?
Any questions, guys?
So is it right to say that DSGE is a good starting point?
No, it's a useless starting point. It's as good a starting point for talking about the economy as Ptolemy's epicycles were for talking about planetary exploration. Unfortunately, none of Ptolemy's astronomers actually tried to fly to Mars. But you know what Mars does in epicycle terms? It does all these little loops flying around the Earth, et cetera, et cetera. And what they're doing is simply adding new epicycles. So if you see what they're doing with DSG models, they're saying, well, you need to include financial frictions. Garbage, throw the whole damn thing out. Okay? It is, and it's even based, there's a 1928 paper I recommend you read by a guy called Ramsey, real polymath, very young man when he wrote the paper. And he talked about, is there an ideal savings rate for an economy? And he argued there was, but to get to that, it was an unstable equilibrium. So to get there, this unstable equilibrium in the future, you had to change what you were doing now. There was only one path that would take you to that point. So if you had a social planner trying to work out the optimum savings level, he would adjust consumption now, up or down, so you got to that equilibrium path over time. Now that's a fantasy, and he was aware it was a fantasy to some extent. That became the basis of how neoclassical economists built originally real business cycle models called RBC models. Then they built DSGE models. Now, you've heard of Robert Solow. Okay, Robert Solow disparages those models completely. He said, when you look at where they come from, they're just a Ramsey model. And he says, how could anybody expect any sensible short to medium term macroeconomics to come out of that setup? And so what he does, if you were giving a presentation in front of Robert Solow, Nobel Prize winner, okay, and it was a DSG model, he would laugh. He said, that's the only response you can give to these things. He said, his reason for saying I laugh is said, imagine you find yourself sitting next to somebody who says he's Napoleon. The stupidest thing you can do is start discussing cavalry tactics at the Battle of Auschwitz. Just laugh at him. Okay. Yep.
What do you suggest governments should do to stop there being financial crises?
They've got to create more money. And this is partly what I do with Minsky as well. This is the modern monetary theory approach, if you've heard of that, MMT. I have some disagreements with some part of the MMT, extending, I think, their ideas too far. But the whole idea that banks create money by lending out more than they get back in repayments is obviously correct. And the government creates more money by spending more than it gets back in taxes. Now, if you have a government running a surplus, that necessarily means it's running a deficit of exactly the same amount with the rest of the economy, whether that's the domestic economy on its own or domestic plus international. So if the government's created more money, there'd be less need for credit-based money. And I'll show you the worst example. I didn't get anywhere near this point in my presentation, but I'll show you Spain. This is, let's see, here we go. That's Spain's level of private debt. Now, most mainstream economists wouldn't have a clue that that's there because they ignore it. But when the euro came into existence, an enormous borrowing bubble occurred in Spain, which gave this huge housing bubble, and it looked like the place was, you know, on the way to becoming the next powerhouse of Europe. Then it ends up with 26% unemployment, which, if I show you the correlation for Spain of unemployment with credit, I think you can see the correlation. It's a mere minus 0.937 since 1990. Now, partly why that's happening is the euro was obsessed about stopping governments spending more than they got back in taxation, and in fact believing that was a good idea. Now, if the government spends less than it gets back in tax, it's taking money out of the private economy. And at the same time, you're expecting the private economy to grow. It's simply bad economics, even without the type of framework I've given you here. Simply looking at money creation, you're destroying money and expecting an economy to grow. Now, what it will do in that situation, if the government's destroying money or not creating enough, you either have to run a trade surplus, which Germany did very nicely, or you have to borrow money from the private banks. So private money creation exceeds the destruction by the government of money. And Spain was actually running a surplus for a fair bit of this time. So the government, in that sense, was destroying money in Spain in the belief that was good economic policy. Well, at the same time, what the Spanish private sector did was borrow to the hilt, which gave you a growing economy until such time as people stopped borrowing money. Then you went from massively positive credit, running in that case about 35% of GDP, down to minus 20. That's why the crisis occurred. So the government, to stop financial crises, one thing it should be doing is spending more than it gets back in taxation and then checking the impact that has on the trade deficit, on an inflation, but seeing it as a tool of government policy to spend more than it gets back in taxation. Otherwise, it's destroying money. Now, you can't do that willy-nilly. You can't do it forever. Okay, you've got to, you can do it forever if you do it at a rate that's proportional to the growth rate of the economy. But you've got to look at the trade deficit and you've got to look at inflation. So you measure whether you should do it or not against its effects. It's completely feasible for the government to do it because the government is the only institution that owns its own bank. If you owned your own bank and people accepted any notes from your bank as full payment of any debt you had, would you be worried about your debt? I wouldn't. Now, I'm worried about my train, though, so I better think about leaving. Yeah, one more.
So many neoclassical influence economists will say that these kind of shocks are pretty common in capitalism and that it's only the market correcting itself. So
no.
What should we care what they say?
You shouldn't care what they say, but you need an alternative analysis at the same time. Yeah.
But I mean, they will say, like, why should we care about these shocks if in the end it's just the market correction?
No. This is the market correction. That if you didn't have bankruptcy, so if you couldn't actually write off debts off, this would be a recipe for a complete collapse of the economy. And you saw how bad Spain and Greece got to be. That was really because they weren't allowed to go through the bankruptcy process. They weren't allowed to spend the government money on the other side and counteract it. So it's a recipe for economic disaster to follow their advice. I better go. Thanks for coming along.